This tutorial shows you how to conduct the independent samples t-test in SPSS and interpret its results. The purpose is testing the means of two groups for differences. For example, I have a trained and an untrained group of people. I want to test for a difference in the average number of push-ups between those two groups. Requirements for the independent samples t-test are the following. Two independent groups, a dependent variable on an interval or ratio scale, an approximate normal distribution of the dependent variable within the respective groups, and equal variances across the groups. Testing for normal distribution is shown in a separate video, linked in the info cards to keep this video more concise. Doing an independent samples t-test requires you to go to Analyze, Means and Proportions, and select the independent samples t-test. Take your test variable and drag it into the box labeled Test Variables. The grouping variable goes into the box that says Grouping Variable. Furthermore, you have to define the groups. If your group variable type is text, you can type in text. If it is numeric, however, with or without value labels, put in the numbers representing the two respective groups you want to compare. The options merely allow you to specify a confidence interval, which is set to 95% by default. Handling missing values can also be left at the default option of case-by-case exclusion. Use the bootstrap option if you run into trouble with the normality assumption. This will generate additional output. Please also make sure that the Estimate Effect Sizes box is checked, which is a feature since SPSS 27. The results will then be shown in the Output Viewer. You will by default get group statistics, the mean, standard deviation, and the standard error of the mean. This will paint a rough picture if the means are different and whether the variances are homogeneous, a requirement you have to check. Speaking of homogeneous variances, this simply means that the variances should be roughly equal. Usually, an I-test is sufficient. Simply square the standard deviation and compare them. A difference of 15 to 20% is usually still considered acceptable. If you absolutely have to do an analytical test, SPSS automatically does the so-called Levene's test. The null hypothesis of the Levene's tests you want to retain is equal variances. In my case, the p-value is well above any typical alpha level of 1% or 5%, and I can assume equal variances, which was also the outcome of my first I-test. Now that you've learned what the Levene's test does, forget about it again. Because 1. In large samples, it can be significant, even for small and unimportant effects or deviations from homogeneity of variance. And 2. In small samples, it will lack power to detect violations of assumptions. The I-test I mentioned earlier should be sufficient in most cases. If you're in doubt, Field advises to simply use the correction for violations regardless, because no violation of homogeneity results in no correction, as we shall see. Depending on whether I test one-sided or two-sided, a different p-value should be looked at. Reminder, one-sided testing is applicable when you expect a certain outcome and want to test for it. For example, I expect my train group to have a higher mean, and once my descriptive statistics reveal means that are aligned with that expectation, I can test one-sided. If you test for only a difference, use the two-sided p-value. If the p-value is below the predefined threshold, for example 0.05, the null hypothesis can be rejected. Reminder, the null hypothesis assumes no difference of the mean between group 1 and 2, or, in my example, trained and untrained. The alternative hypothesis of the independent t-test is that you are actually proposing one- or two-sided results. In my case, I defined alpha as 0.05 and can therefore reject the null hypothesis. Since I'm testing one-sided, I'll focus on the one-sided p-value, which is 0.007, rounded to 3 decimals. Note, the two-sided p-value is always double of the one-sided p-value. The slight difference here is due to rounding. I can conclude that the means, 61 and 52.6, are different. After a significant two-sample t-test, the effect size should also be looked at. Please note that versions prior to SPSS 27 do not provide that table, and you have to calculate the effect size manually. When it comes to effect sizes, SPSS provides 3 different ones. Glass delta can usually be ignored since it only uses the standard deviation of the control group. The choice is therefore between D and Hedges' correction of it. Consult the literature, especially Grissom, Kim, 2012, and the respective formulas. Finally, you have to classify the magnitude of this effect. If similar studies in your research field exist, compare your effect size with the given one. If no comparable study exists, use the common thresholds within your research field. If those are also non-existent, you can refer to Cohen 92, a power primer. Page 157 shows 3 thresholds for the two-sample t-test, 0.2, 0.5 and 0.8 for small, medium and large effect sizes. In my example, the Hedges correction of Cohen's D is clearly above 0.8 and can be classified as a large effect. When you're done, you have to write up the results. The video that appears now will show you how.